when you lose those healthy microbes, the unhealthy microbes start to proliferate. Now, the thing that took me a while to accept this, one of the things that happens is fecal microbes. These are species like E. coli, Klebsiella, Campylobacter, Salmonella, which you may recognize, by the way, because they're also the microbes of food poisoning. In many people, by my estimation, 50% of the U.S. population has allowed these fecal microbes to ascend into the 24 feet of small intestine, up into the ileum, jejunum, duodenum, and stomach. So 24 feet of fecal microbes colonizing the small intestine. Well, the small intestine is not suited to deal with these fecal microbes. It has a single layer of mucus barrier, unlike the colon, where fecal microbes are supposed to be. And there's a thicker two-layer mucus barrier. So fecal microbes gain access to the small intestine, 24 feet, trillions of them. And, you know, microbes only live for about a few hours. So there's rapid turnover. When they die, some of their components, but specifically something called endotoxin, gets entry through that thin mucus barrier into the bloodstream. And that's called endotoxemia. And that's one of the ways by which microbes gain access and export their effects to the joints and get you experience as fibromyalgia or rheumatoid arthritis, to the brain as depression or dementia or Lou Gehrig's disease or Parkinson's disease, or metabolically through the blood, obesity, type 2 diabetes, fatty liver, to the skin, rosacea, psoriasis, eczema. In other words, we've got to rethink virtually all modern disease in light of the contribution or even the initiating cause in the microbiome. So this is changing almost everything we thought we knew about healthcare. Yeah, if you break your leg, that's still a broken leg. But type 2 diabetes, obesity, autoimmune diseases, neurodegenerative disorders, fibromyalgia, restless leg syndrome, all those things we've got to reconsider because there's a major contribution. And if all your doctor does, for instance, for your diabetes or obesity, is give you a drug to reduce your blood sugar, they've not done you a favor. All they've done is reduce your blood sugar. They did not address the underlying cause or contributing factors in the microbiome. So antibiotics, preservatives, all those things, emulsifying agents, we've lost literally hundreds of species of bacteria in the colon, where these many of these microbes, maybe some of them aren't so important, but many are very important. One of the things they did was they kept unhealthy microbes suppressed. Another thing I should mention is one of the most important things your listeners can do is to bring back fermented foods into their diet. Kimchi, kombucha, kefirs, yogurt, not the garbage in the store, fermented veggies you can make on your kitchen counter. It can be almost cost without cost, except for the vegetables. You can do it on your kitchen counter. It's very easy to do because those are filled with healthy microbes, like with weird names, like Leuconostoc mesenteroides and Pediococcus pentosaceus and Lactobacillus plantarum. Interestingly, these microbes in fermented foods don't themselves take up residence. They simply pass through, but somehow, no one knows exactly how, their presence seems to open the door to other healthy microbes. So you're restoring diverse species by consuming lots of fermented foods. I tell people, think of your gastrointestinal microbiome like a garden in your backyard. So let's pretend it's May and you want to start a garden. So you maybe have a 10 by 10 plot, right? You're going to pick out the rocks and the sticks, right? And then you're going to plant seeds. Then you water and fertilize your garden. And then in a couple of months or whatever, you have a bunch of tomatoes and cucumbers and zucchini. The gut floor is the same. We're going to clean the soil. Well, how do you do that? Filter your water, remove the chlorine and fluoride, avoid antibiotics whenever possible. You know, if your doctor tries to prescribe and question whether this is really necessary or not, avoid processed foods with additives like emulsifying agents, avoid synthetic sweeteners like aspartame and saccharin and sucralose. So there's a long list of things you can do. Now, what are the seeds to re-implant healthy microbes? Fermented foods, hands down, the most effective thing you can do. Commercial probiotics, by the way, they're of limited usefulness because they're haphazard collections of microbes. There's going to be a lot of new science coming out that's going to make probiotics, commercial probiotics, a much better thing, but that's only starting now. For instance, they haven't incorporated what are called collaborative or guild effects, where microbes, like humans, collaborate and cooperate with each other. That's not yet been incorporated to most commercial probiotics. So right now, commercial probiotics are of limited usefulness. They do help, but only a little bit. And then lastly, feed your microbes, just like in water and fertilizer. Prebiotic fibers, polysaccharides, these are from plant materials like asparagus and leeks and dandelion greens and onions and garlic and shallots and legumes to provide galacto-oligosaccharides. This is a long list that seems complicated, but think of it like a garden. It's easy. And you make these things happen. Incorporate a fermented food and a prebiotic fiber in every meal. Make it a habit. It becomes very easy.